So, hi, Zurich, very nice. Fucking expensive. Crazy. I mean, I was like, when I landed here, like, oh my god, these prices. Anyway, I got married 3 months ago. And I hired a wedding photographer, naturally, right? So, we had a couple of meetings before the wedding. In order to pinpoint the details, to pick out all the stuff that he needed to do and I needed to do. And, you know, coincidentally, in one of the meetings, the topic of WordPress came up. And we were speaking about his website, and, you know, the first question that I asked him is, like, how many visitors do you have, right? And what he said really kind of struck me in a way. And he said, I have no idea. He had no idea how many visitors he has. Unlike Mendel, who doubled them in the past year. So what I, of course, naturally said is like, okay, you should just, you know, install Google Analytics. This is what most of us do when we launch a website. But come to think of it, the question itself, how many visitors do you have, was wrong. And the suggestion of just installing Google Analytics was also wrong. So today, in this talk, I'd like to present to you what I should really have told my wedding photographer, and I'm hoping to see this video on WordPress.tv. So, who am I? Like Mo said, I'm Tomaz Zaman. I'm from Slovenia. I'm a developer, used to be a freelancer. I'm a project manager. And in general, I would say I solve problems. I'm also a bit stupid sometimes. I founded Kodalo. Basically, it's like Airbnb or maybe even Tinder, the matchmaking service between people that require WordPress services and between people that offer WordPress services. So that's what you do. On to the story. You've all seen this, right? I mean, who doesn't know what this screen is? Okay, no one. Oh, my top picture was very interesting. Okay. So, you know what it is? And Mendel, I'm going to shatter your dreams right now. It's just noise. It's nothing. The number of visitors means nothing. No offense, Mendel, I'll elaborate on it, so we'll be friends again after the talk. So, yes. Imagine having a store in a shopping mall or in a street and people passing by looking at your store. This is what visitor counts mean. It's just people that look at your content. And that's it. It doesn't give you the big picture. In fact, it doesn't give you any picture. You don't know who those people are. You don't know what these people do. You don't know anything. You get a number. For example, you install Jetpack. You get this nice graph. Oh, my visitor count is going up. And hunky-dory, we're all happy. Well, it doesn't work like that. So before I continue, I think it's worth establishing the single most important purpose of any and every website. And it's only one word. Would anybody like to guess or know this word?
Passion.
Exactly. This word is conversion. Every website's purpose is to convert. But not convert in this kind of way, of course. So what they really want to convert you in is convert a visitor to a paying customer. This is the event that the conversion occurs. So when somebody gives you their money, they are turned from the role of just being a passerby into somebody who gave you their money. Now, I need to also stress that it's not always about money. For example, in Mendel's case, of course, the people can't buy stuff that he writes about. So his conversion goal would maybe be increasing Twitter followers, increasing Facebook friends, increasing subscribers that consume more content from him. So the conversion goals may vary from business owner or a blogger to blogger, but it's always the same conversion. Does anybody remember gas stations back in the old days? You remember when your dad took you to the gas station? There were no shops at the gas stations like 20 years ago, right? You drove your car to the gas station, you stop your father or your mother said stop the car, the person would stand, the person that worked there would stand outside, they would put gas into your car, they would collect the money, and you would drive off. Now, because the gas prices are regulated by the government, they couldn't increase their revenue. So what most of the gas station companies did is they introduced these shops. So now, not only you have to go to pay for the gas yourself, you also need to go inside the petrol station and go through these maze of corridors before you finally get to the cashier to pay for your gas, right? And we think it's super annoying, but at the same time, we always grab a small candy bar or a small drink on our way to the cashier, right? So they have been increasing conversion, they can be increasing revenue by allowing people to spend more. Now imagine that a petrol station had an aisle that would go right to the cashier, but in front of the this aisle, there would be a huge box, right, or something. And it would prevent you from between entering and getting to the cashier. So what you would do, eventually, you would be frustrated and you would leave. Now, when you think of it, I mean, imagining that on a gas station sounds pretty ridiculous, right? But how or why do we do it on our website then? We all are guilty of this thing. And let me tell you who the main bad guy of this story is. WordPress. Yeah, I know. Some of you are going like, what? And I'm not talking about WordPress as a CMS. It's a nice CMS. Of course, it has its issues. But so do I, and don't still let me talk here. So, there is one important question that we, as a community at large, fail to ask ourselves. And that is, why? Why do I publish some piece of content? Why do I download and install a plugin? Why am I downloading WordPress? Why do I want a website? Because Simon Sinek, in his talk, How Great Leaders Inspire Innovation, talks about this golden circle, right? And it's what most companies out there do. And this golden circle asks three questions, right? Why, how, and what? And the order is usually like this. So first is the what. What we are doing. What do I want to do? Then it's how. What is the website, of course. How? WordPress, of course. But why is a question that often goes unanswered. So Simon argued that the best companies out there invert this process. They start by asking themselves, their employees, and their customers, why, right? Who hasn't heard of Revolution Slider? Right? Why? Revolution, not just Revolution Slider, sliders are useless. The only reason they sail, if I look at the Revolution Slider, and I'm not trying to pick on those guys, is that the site owners feel important, feel happy, feel ecstatic that something is moving. When it's, proven times and times again that sliders are useless, are worthless, they don't convert, they don't convey information, they are just there for the owner himself or herself to feel good about it. So, when we're talking about the why, let's see how these two companies kind of approach this. Hopefully I'll manage to pitch at least half of you right now. So, Apple versus Samsung, right? So, they're getting better, but let's start. If you start at Samsung, it was always like this. You came to the shop, to the aisle with computers, and you see this computer, the what? It has this processor, the how, so how they are building this computer, another computer, another tablet, another computer, and the lines were endless. You had like 50,000 gazillion products that you could choose from. And that's a problem in itself, but in contrast to what Apple does on the other hand, have you seen commercials commercials by Apple, right? You have Johnny Ive with his velvet voice saying something like, because we feel you are frequent, because we know you're a frequent traveler, because we know you're a busy man, because we know. So it's always the reason first, and the how and the what comes last, right? So if you've seen any of the keynotes, Steve Jobs back in the days, or Tim Cook now, they always present the what last. So they introduce the problem first. Why addresses the problem? And they finally get to like introducing the new super awesome MacBook Pro. So this is the difference. Good companies ask why first. And good developers should always ask why first. Even when your clients have issues or requests about certain features, make themselves ask why, or you ask them. So, how do we make the noise that I introduced earlier on Google Analytics into something meaningful? So, how do we make the picture clearer? Well, we start usually by introducing events. Now, this talk is not very technical, but I'm going to show just a small snippet. This is how easy it is to track events on your website. An event may be anything. From a person visiting your store is an event, on them clicking a button is an event, then clicking a link to another site is an event. Every action they make is an event. So if we apply this knowledge to our store that I spoke of earlier, let's say we counted people, which is like visitor count, and we say, okay, we have 1,000 people pass by, or 1,000 events of persons passing by. 50 people enter our store, and 5 of them actually buy the product. Now we have a lot of meaningful data that we can extract useful information from. And this is what we call a funnel. You know what a funnel is, right? You've all seen it. Mendel has first-hand experience. He's from US. You're big on this. I'm just kidding, Mendel. So, yes, what the funnel really looks like is like this. So, let's imagine an e-commerce funnel. We have a visitor that comes on a page. We have a visitor that adds a product, that checks out, and yeah, receives a thank you mail. I'm just giving an example, but this is what the real funnel looks like. So now your visitor, you give perspective to your visitors to what they do, how many they check out, and you should always focus when you look at the funnels of events, you should always focus on the ones that drop the most. That will usually be between the first and the second. So for example, you have somebody visiting your landing page which has a button, and they only a small tiny percent clicks that button, but the majority of those actually see the path through, so they actually buy it. So you should focus at that point on the biggest drop off. Also improving the visibility of the button, improving the color of the button, we'll get there. So yes, how do I improve the funnel? That's the question. And there are 3 ways to do that. The first one is writing A/B tests. Who here doesn't know what A/B tests are? Okay, cool. So, the second part is awesome customer support, we'll get there. And the third one is improving user experience. Let's talk about A/B tests first. A/B testing is a quite simple process of showing different variants of the same element to your visitors. For example, imagine a button. You can show on the same page, you can actually show different button variants to the same to audience that is automatically split. So if we have these 4 buttons on our landing page, 25% of visitors will see the first one, 25% the second, and 25% the third, and so forth. So, and this is not up to you to implement, it's easy to implement, and we'll get there as well. So, have I introduced it clearly enough?
Yeah.
Okay, thank you. So, and it's also important that you A/B test the why. Headlines on any landing page is the most read piece of content your website has. When they come, when your visitors come on your website, the biggest header will be read first and pretty much by everyone. So when you start with A/B testing, I usually recommend that we should all start with A/B testing the why. So it's not what we do that usually websites say, we do this and this with this. Try, maybe it will work, maybe it won't, like why we do what we do. And here I have no affiliation with Optimizely, but I really recommend them. You can try them out. Basically, you don't need to do anything on your WordPress. You just get a small snippet, just like Google Analytics snippet. You implement it, and then you do everything their way. And their free plan is good for majority of us for a long time. So it's good enough. I suggest you give it a try. They you know, enable easy testing of elements, buttons, pictures, layouts, whatever you need. I don't know why this slide is here actually. So yeah, I just like brainstorm, I guess. So the next part is customer support. By providing good customer support, you not only create happy visitors, happy customers, you convert them well, you manually improve the funnel, because people that speak to you person to person or through online chat are more inclined to convert, because it's easy than for you to talk them into purchasing. And for example, we implemented one of these on our website, and it converts crazy. So basically, when they have any kind of pre-sale question, they click the button, they ask the question, we give it to them, they usually hire one of our developers. So what you create with chatting live with your customers is, in a way, you get ambassadors for free. And it's a huge win. And it works. And what's more important, they provide a lot of honest feedback that you want to hear. So always talk to your customers. I mean, it's really easy to find hide behind the screens. But we need to realize it's a human being on the end, on the other end of the line. The third part is user experience. User experience is a huge broad topic, so I won't dive very, very deep. But user experience teaches us that it's not always about the numbers, right? It's easy to track people. It's easy to look at Google Analytics. It's easy to look to optimize it. It's easy to look at the numbers and make sense of them. And we do make sense of them. So what that is the quantitative part of user experience research. Qualitative, on the other hand, means that we have to visit our users, our readers, our consumers, and sit next to them and look at what they're doing. So numbers are only half of the story, right? So once we, with Codable back in the days, we did a user testing session. It was our first. We met a user experience professional, and he invited us over to the office where we would perform user experience session. And what it looked like was, he found some people to test our website in, so to see how they interact with our application. He gave them the scenario to follow, and I was sitting like that, there, just observing what they did. So the first person went through the scenario, went through the application, submitted the project brief, and he came to the next page, and he didn't know how to continue. And I was like thinking to myself, what the fuck? It's like, who's there? But you're not allowed to say anything, of course, because you're biased then. But like, dude, it's like over there. Nothing. He abandoned the process. So I was like, what's wrong with these people, right? The second one, the same same story. The third one, the same story. But the bottom line, what I learned from this experience, and it sticks with me to this day, and I'd love to share it, is that it's not their fault that they don't find the button. It's our fault that we don't present it clearly enough. So you can have the fanciest copy that you tested, micro copies or what the button said. You can have the fanciest, most expensive designer, but if you don't test with your users, this is what you get. So, to recap, you should always try to first build in the funnels, and then improving it or improving them by A/B testing, by providing awesome customer support, and taking UX into huge consideration. Because anyone can publish stuff and set up WordPress. Anyone can use Google Analytics or Jetpack to track their visitors. Anyone can give you their business card, but it takes a real pro to convert visitors to customers. Are you that pro?